All right. So, Nathan, we had to watch a musical this week.
If I may, I've actually prepared something for the opening.
Let me guess. This was trash, 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 trash.
Well, I mean, if you'll indulge me, give it a shot. Deny it before you try it.
Here comes the negativity. Have at it.
This was a movie, yes, had music too, the sort of thing I normally eschew, but I had some fun, it made me sing, but still I have to ask us all, what were they thinking?
Pick a movie. That's when I'm under pressure now. The question always comes back to me, what were they thinking now? Whoa, what were they thinking? What were they
Yes, welcome everyone. We are back after our 6-day absence, of course. We are out of Schlocktober sequel month, but here's the thing. We're making a kind of slow, steady transition back into our regular fare because this one is close to, it's kind of horror elements in it, but we'll get into
adjacent.
It. Yes. No, Jason is a horror figure.
Adjacent.
I know.
You need to get your ears checked.
I'm just being a little scamp. But anyway, you heard that other voice. Yes, I'm Brendan, and this is the What Were They Thinking podcast, where we talk about bad to questionable movies. Joining me is the, let's just say, the phantom to my Christine, Nathan.
Eric, if you don't mind.
Yeah, I didn't even know until I read about it after. I was like, I don't remember him ever saying his name is Eric in this version.
No, he doesn't, no.
Yeah, I didn't think so. Or if he did, it was very quick and I missed it. Yeah, Nathan, we're talking about a musical. And judging from that cold open, I think you're going to get some surprising takes in this one, folks. This is The Phantom of the Opera 2004.
So there you go.
Yeah. But joining us, of course, on this episode is a Winter's Tale and Phantom of the Opera expert, ladies and gentlemen, Sharon Horwatt.
I'm back!
Bitches!
It's amazing. I don't know how it happened. Somehow I just snuck in with my magical horse.
To say that your theme is magical horses because this movie
have notes.
Also has a magical
as do
horse.
I about as many as last time, actually a little bit less. It's like 5 pages.
Yes, so Phantom of the Opera 2004, the only film adaptation, of course, of the source material, along with the 82 other film adaptations of the source material.
Well, in this case, if you're counting the source material as the Andrew Lloyd Webber musical, then yes, this is the only adaptation of that.
I mean, no, there's other adaptations. This is
other adaptations of Phantom of the Opera, the Gaston Leroux novel in which the musical is based upon. But this is the only musical movie that's based on the Andrew Lloyd Webber musical.
There are other musical adaptations as well, just not this one. And Andrew Lloyd Webber was stupid enough to make a musical sequel, which is also terrible.
Did you really not know this?
I did not know that there was a Phantom sequel.
Have you ever heard of Love Never Dies?
No.
No. Ooh, I know what we're gonna do next year. Legit worse than this, but it's fun, but it's bad. It's perfect.
But was it a stage sequel before it was a movie sequel?
Well, it was a stage sequel. And he's been trying to get it. Like, it was in the West End. And it did so badly over there, he hasn't been able to get it to actually come to Broadway. But there is like a recording of the stage show that is easily watchable. It's pretty rough, my dude.
Wonderful. But this is the 2004 version of Phantom of the Opera, a movie
that
I
apparently
saw.
Should have been the 1989 version of Phantom of the Opera.
Yes. Apparently, originally, they were just going to make the movie with Sarah Brightman and Michael Crawford back in the day. But as soon as production was going to start, Sarah Brightman was like, never mind, I don't want to be married to Andrew anymore, which was probably a good call on her part, considering how much of a shady bitch he is.
Andrew Lloyd Webber is a weirdo. Let's not forget he also made Cats.
Yes. He also treats his workers absolutely poorly, but we don't have enough time to get into that. We have too much time for other things.
Doesn't shock me. But this movie I did actually see in the movie theaters. I realized as I started watching this. We've got Gerard Butler, we've got Emmy Rossum, we've got Patrick Wilson, Miranda Richardson, Minnie Driver, who's not doing her own singing except for I think one song.
At the end.
We got Simon. Yeah, we've got Simon Callow, the Four Weddings and a Funeral fame, Ciaran Hinds, and others.
Mm-hmm.
This movie is nominated for 3 Oscars: Best Art Direction, Best Cinematography, and Best Original Song. Learn to Be Lonely. It does not win any of those, but it is a multiple Oscar nominated film.
So what you're getting at is Suicide Squad was better because it won an Oscar.
Clearly is not the measure I use to dictate what's good and not, because that is not the case.
Well, doesn't that also mean that Pearl Harbor is better too?
Now you're speaking my language. So Phantom of the Opera 2004. Yes, this is a version of Andrew Lloyd Webber's musical, and the plot, right? Well, okay. It's based on Phantom of the Opera. You know how it goes. It's,
plot.
So now we're in an opera house. This is just the basics, guys. We're in an opera house. There is a phantom. There's some sort of a weird, dark, phantomy figure called the Phantom living in the upper, you know, balcony in his own little tucked away place in the opera. And he's in the basement. He's in the top part. He's all over the place. But he basically dictates what goes on behind the scenes. Straight up threats of violence and horrible
actual
repercussions.
Violence.
Yeah.
He does some light murder.
Some light
garroting
murder that looks like suicide, you know, just casual stuff. He really wants this young up and coming performer, Christine, to play the lead role in the new the new opera. So much so that he threatens, of course, as he does. That's his calling card. That if it doesn't happen, terrible things will happen. Also, he wants his money that he makes for essentially doing nothing. I mean, come on. He makes a paycheck for nothing, guys.
He needs it for all of his torture chambers that he magically has in the sewers, obviously.
Yeah. So, of course, throughout the course of the movie, we find out that he taught her how to sing over the years. So he feels like it's she's owed to him. There is a weird romantic connection, one of two weird romantic connections as we get another suitor.
I would
suitor.
Say the weirdest.
Yeah, we get another suitor later in the movie played by Patrick Wilson. That's kind of odd too. Lots of music, lots of singing. Hilarity ensues. So let's get started.
Okay.
I want to start by saying that it was so quiet for the first like 45 seconds as nothing was as the credits were popping up that I thought my sound
was
wrong
with my TV.
Dude,
yes.
I thought the same thing too. It's been so long since I saw this movie. I completely forgot that it's basically dead silence for 45 seconds. And then I had it all the way up and then it just got really loud all of a sudden. I was like, we're going all the way back down here now.
Yeah, I was watching this at work and I was just like, are my computer speakers just not working? Like, what is going on? And then it was like, I was like, oh shit. So it starts off quick. We're in Paris, 1919. Black and white. It's before they had color in real life, too. Everything was just in black and white.
Sapien.
We're at a public auction, and people are, like, you know, selling off a bunch of old paintings and shit. Nothing special.
But then we see something very special there. A papier-mâché musical box in the shape of a barrel organ. Attached, a figure of a monkey in Persian robes playing the cymbals.
I was just about to say, at first, though, it's just old paintings and stuff. And then, yes, the organ with the cymbal playing monkey. And it's very enticing to Miranda Richardson and Patrick Wilson in their old age makeup.
I have a question, though. Is that actually Miranda Richardson, though? Or is it Jennifer Ellison? Because they look related.
Well, I think they say that that's her. I think I actually looked up on Wikipedia.
It's supposed to be older Madame Giry, not
I believe
Meg?
So.
Okay.
I thought it was supposed to be, I thought it was older Meg.
I wasn't sure.
I don't know.
I wasn't sure. It's not a big deal. I'm just like, I don't know who this is.
I would figure that a Madame Giry would have been, you know, dead at that point. But.
Yeah.
No, it is Madame Giry.
Oh.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, then who? Well, I mean, that's not a surprise. Who the fuck cares about Meg, I guess?
Yeah. Who'd Meg ever kill? So, yeah, they're admiring this from afar. And then Patrick Wilson, a.k.a. Raoul, ends up winning the monkey. And then, you know, he sings about it for a little bit of time, as you do. But the hot item at this auction is a giant chandelier that fell.
In pieces.
And it all originates with the tale of the Phantom of the Opera. And then, we get the...
of the Phantom of the Opera.
What?
That's what he says.
Some of you may remember the strange affair of the Phantom of the Opera.
Yes.
A mystery never fully explained.
And then, of course, we got the... and we go to...
They attach wirings for the new electric light.
Yes.
Perhaps
we
may frighten away the ghosts of so many years ago with a little illumination,
gentlemen. Exactly. We're just... Brendan, you brought this on yourself. I'm so sorry.
No, he had no idea. He had no idea.
I didn't bring anything on myself. You were the one who requested this movie.
Hey, you're the one that said that was fine. So...
One thing I think is strange, because Paris 1919, it's black and white, and then we go to Paris 1870 in full lavish color. I was like, wait, we're going back further in time, but now we're in color. Weird, kind of a weird choice.
Because it was before the Great War, so people were
so they had color then.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then the Great War was in black and white, and
right,
then after
the,
that there was
color Ottoman Empire stole all the color. All we had left was sepia until they defeated them.
I didn't know that's what started the war.
Obviously.
Okay. Well, we see an absolutely lavish stage performance being prepared. Mm-hmm. And starring, of course, Carlotta, the diva lead opera singer / actress played by Minnie Driver.
Madonna.
She is amazing. I love her in this.
She is hamming it up.
Yes.
That's the thing I didn't care for. That the fact that they take, because in this they play her abilities for jokes. Like,
I don't like that. I agree. I find it very weird that, especially like the people who work in the opera house are like, there's like one part where they show the workers in like the house just like putting like cotton in their ears of like, her singing. It's terrible. It's like, what the fuck are you talking about? She sounds amazing. In my opinion, I know that's not her voice, which again kind of drives me up the wall, because it's like, why would you hire her if you know that you're going to replace her in the first place?
In the original stage production, she is a legitimately good singer.
Mm.
And she only gets kind of put out of her way because of the interference of the Phantom interfering on Christine's behalf. In this, they make it seem like she, I don't know, bought her way onto the stage or slept her way onto the stage. Like, she's not a very good singer, but because she's nailing one of the producers, she's you know, the lead in Hannibal the Musical.
I'm gonna go ahead and guess that this is the movie's way of making it easier for us not to feel bad for her.
I guess
because if she was talented, if we saw her doing pretty well and not basically being a cartoon character, we probably have a little bit of empathy.
Oh,
but
I don't
mind making her so ridiculously over the top and such like a bad singer and everything. It's like, oh, okay, well, I don't care if she gets replaced.
I don't mind her being like a complete diva and you know, just pushing and bossing everybody around to make me feel not feel bad for her because of that. Like, she's an awful person and deserves these things that happen to her.
Mm-hmm.
But I mean, I think making her a cartoonishly bad singer is just a hat on a hat.
Yeah, it's too much. Which,
well, I think they're just doubling down, though. I think they're just like, well, we better make sure no one likes her. Like, we better make sure she's also untalented.
Which, again, that doesn't really play for me. Because, again, she's just like, she sounds great. It's not like they got a bad singer to play her.
Yeah.
And just be like, oh, the only reason she's here is because, again, she's sleeping with the guy that owns the opera. Like, because they don't do that. So it's weird that everybody hates her.
This isn't like Florence Foster Jenkins or anything here. Like, she's belting it out, and it sounded fine to me. I don't know. But anyway, as they're rehearsing their song, we see the arrival of some gentlemen who they interrupt everything. And at first, of course, me having absolutely no knowledge of the source material, the musical, nothing, except for having seen this movie once in theaters, apparently, they're walking through and I was like, who let the tour group through the middle of this performance, this rehearsal? But it's not. It's the guy that owns the theater, and he's announcing these two gentlemen are now the new owners, Furman and Andre, played by Ciaran Hinds and Simon Callow, respectively. They have some funny moments in this movie. And they also announced the new patron of the theater, and it's Raoul, played by Patrick Wilson, who looks a hair younger than 12.
The Vicomte de Chagny.
Yes.
Yes.
Every time I wrote his name down, it was Raoul, because that is a lot to write.
Well, also they introduced that dumb joke that I hated every time, which is that they made money from scrap metal, actually. And it's why the fuck is that there? It's not in the stage show at all. And it's not funny either time that they do it. And I don't understand why they include it, because it's not even just like a meh. It's just like,
You gotta have jokes.
Is that funny? Because I'm not laughing.
Mr. Schumacher, we don't have any jokes in this scene. Scrap metal. Thanks.
Yeah, that's just something him and Lord Andy came up with on their free time.
Put nipples on the suits.
Put nipples.
No, they put them on the statues.
There you go. Sorry with the late breaking. I'm sure Brendan will fix this in post, but due to an issue with the with some power in Brendan's area, the remainder of the episode is just going to be Sharon
and me. A joke everybody loves to do for me. It never gets old.
It never gets old.
It never gets old. That and sharing jokes.
So, okay. So, where we left off, we met the Vicomte, Raoul, played by Patrick Wilson.
He looks like he's 12.
Dylan Fairplay hair. Yeah, yeah.
Yes.
He looks like Dylan Fairplay with hockey hair from Letterkenny.
His hair is so long and it looks so weird. it's weird for him, I guess, is what I should say. Because I'm used to him in like the Conjuring franchise and Insidious, where it's pretty
with
short.
The short hair. Well, I don't think I've actually. I think this is one of the first times I think I've ever seen him with long hair in a movie.
Same.
So, yeah. Okay, so we're also kind of introduced to the idea that Carlotta is la diva of this whole thing, because she does a bit. From because they're practicing Hannibal the Musical, and Hannibal has his own mini-me and everything.
Why is that there?
I don't know. That was such a weird thing for me. I was like, why does he have a mini-me?
And he's in all the other performances too, which is extra weird.
He's like that little person that Marlon Brando insisted being on set for The Island of Dr. Moreau.
I was going to say the same like thing. Oh my God, that's so funny.
She's kind of accosted by the Phantom, and all these accidents, they allude to the idea that all these accidents keep happening,
right?
And
the slowest background drop in the universe. They're just like, it's like that Zamboni thing from Austin Powers. I'm like, no. Oh, we also forgot to mention the very important detail that Christine is like, Raoul, we were childhood sweethearts. And you're like, honey, how old were you?
Okay, but I mean, doesn't she kind of explain that she is younger than him by more than a couple of years, because she makes it sound like she had, like, you know, like a schoolgirl crush on this guy who was maybe older, maybe, you know, 15 or 16 at the time. Mm-hmm. And he just kind of, you know, oh, you're a little sweetheart, and he knows it, but, you know, it's a cute little schoolgirl crush. He even had a nickname, Little Lottie. Mm-hmm. And then she kind of jokes, you might say, that we were childhood sweethearts. So the maid, I was like, okay, she's making kind of fun of it. But in all seriousness, the age difference between the two actors in real life
is twice.
It's there. It's big.
Mm-hmm.
And but I mean, even the fact that, I mean, you know, you could say it makes it super creepy, but it also makes it extra, you know, 19th century.
Sure. You could say that. Yeah. If you wanted to.
The only way you can explain it away, I guess.
That's the best we can do under the circumstances, I guess.
Yeah.
Maybe.
So because this incredibly slow falling of the backdrop, Carlotta is refusing. She will not go. In fact, she even says, because somebody says, Madame, these things do happen.
These things do happen. For the past 3 years, these things do happen. And did you stop them happening? No. And you
do. This doers, thing does not happen.
Amato andiamo. Amateurs.
Someone suggests Christine can sing the song. And she does. And we have this beautiful transition, because they go from being just in the rehearsal to, like, the full on, the house is full, and it's a big production, and Raoul sees her, has his, you know, it dawns on him, you know, that's Christine.
It's that child I knew.
I think he actually, they had the bit where he has the line in the song where she's really not a bit the gawkish girl that once I knew.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
That's the line.
Oh, gosh.
Oh, that once you were. That's what it is.
Yeah. Oh, this is like a very minor thing. This is a very, very, very nitpicky thing, but it kind of bothers me that Madame Giry's the one that suggests that Christine take over, because in the show it's Meg. And I mean, one, Meg doesn't get much to do anyway, so this is one less thing for her to do. But like, they don't take, in the show, it very much feels like they see Madame Giry as like the one who knows shit, and they like trust her because they don't know anything about the opera house. So when she tells them, no, listen to her, like she's been well taught, it's like, okay, fine. Like, we'll listen to you. So if Madame Giry is the one that keeps insisting on it, it kind of feels like weirdly undercut. For some reason. Sorry, that was like a very nitpicky thing, but it really bothers me.
That's fine. As we said before, unfortunately Brendan left us, the opera house, the opera populaire has been sold to these two chaps, and the previous owner says something to the effect of, if you need me, I'll be in Australia, which I thought was a great
line. Yes. If you need me, don't need me, basically.
Yeah. Oh, don't forget 20,000 francs to the Phantom.
That's
for
so
doing
much
nothing.
Money.
Right.
For the torture chambers that he builds under the opera house, obviously.
True.
Or the floodlights that are magically there, but we'll get to that.
she does the song Think of Me, which, you know, good rendition. We then cut to back to her dressing room, where she's looking at a picture of her father, because through all the exposition in this, we find out her dad was a violinist.
Yes, they say he's supposed to be a Swedish violinist, which a very important thing about who is playing the Phantom is that he is being played by Ramin Karimloo, who, for people who have seen the 25th anniversary, like myself, know that he plays Phantom in that. And at the time,
oh, okay. He's the one in the picture. Yes, Christine's dad.
Yes, and he's okay. In the flashback in the bed that where we can't see his face hardly. But he is the only person who has ever played the Phantom, Raoul, and her father, which is very impressive. And he is also Iranian, which is important if you've read the book because of the Persian character.
This really chips away at my joke that I wrote here that Pete Davidson was her dad.
Aw. That seems mean.
The filter that they use to make it look like an old timey picture, it makes it look like an old timey picture of Pete Davidson.
I mean, it's not there, but like he still has all of his tattoos, so.
Yeah, okay. We get a brief snippet of Angel of Music,
mm-hmm.
but it is interrupted because Christine and Raoul meet again.
She's in the chapel, which by the way, I find it weird that they include that dialogue of her being like, hey, do you remember when I when I came here for the first time and I talked about this Angel of Music, and then they still sing like the beginning where she's like, a father once spoke of an angel, like when they include that bit. So it's kind of weird that they have her speak dialogue so then the phantom Raoul goes and visits Christine, and then we start doing that thing that I hate in this adaptation, which is we speak dialogue that was meant to be sung and sounds dumb Lottie, let her mind wander. It's like, you should be speaking. Little Lottie should be singing this dialogue, singing it or speaking
it. You remember that one too?
Oh no!
Brendan has returned!
So this is where we start doing the thing that this movie does that I really hate, which is that a lot of the lyrics that were sung in the stage show are spoken, and they should not be spoken because it is lyrics that are very clearly like things that are okay to be sung, and they should not be spoken because it sounds fucking stupid when you sing them.
Please elaborate.
What, you don't think
the dialogue specifically?
Like, little Lottie, let her mind wander. Little Lottie, am I fonder of dolls or of goblins or of shoes or of riddles or frocks? Like, excuse me?
These are lyrics. Why are you talking like that?
These are lyrics that are
in all fairness, though, people will introduce a lyric into a conversation inadvertently, and I immediately followed up with a spoken version of the lyric that comes afterwards in that song.
Right.
And hey, everybody, Brendan's back. Hey.
Yay! He's back. We're so happy. It took us like who knows how long.
Yeah, this is like maybe the most issues we've had in a while.
I think Outbreak is the only thing bigger I can think of.
Yeah, guys, I'm back. I'm back like scoliosis. So let's continue from where we left off. I was in the dark for a while. It was scary.
Don't worry, we covered the fact that Pete Davidson was Christine's dad.
Oh, perfect.
Yes.
Okay, so after this whole conversation, we finally get what we all paid money for, and that's the Phantom appearing and singing, you know, "Come to me, strange angel." Oh, wait, she says, "Come to me, strange angel."
Yeah. Right?
Yeah, because he's the angel.
Yes. And it's also funny because when he's like, was it when Raoul, he's like, and now we're going to go have supper. And she's like, no, Raoul, the Angel of Music is very strict. And he's like, okay, well, you go ahead and you change, and I'm going to go get the carriage.
She's like, Angel of Music says I can only be out till 8 o'clock, Raoul.
Excuse you. And it's a weird part because she doesn't just run after him. And like, she's still in her costume, so she could. But like in the stage version, it kind of makes sense why she doesn't run after him, because at this point she's like, in a robe. She's like half out of her costume. So like if she ran out, she could get in trouble. So it's weird that she doesn't just run after him.
Well, doesn't he lock her in?
Yeah, but she doesn't know that yet. That hasn't... No, that's... The Phantom locks her in. But again, she doesn't know that yet. Because it's that mysterious masked hand that we've been seeing.
Right.
So it's definitely the Phantom that locks her in.
And the Phantom is, you know, he's making his appearance. He's singing about how this Raoul boy is a little too wonky wonk. He's no good, blah, blah, blah. And now
I believe he was an insolent boy, a slave of fashion.
Basking in Christine's glory.
an incel boy, a slave of fashion. And now we get the Phantom of the Opera is there. And Joel
behind
Schumacher
the mirror.
Joel Schumacher chose this moment to go as batshit crazy as possible. The spectacle of this whole musical number, the overdramatic vocal performance from Gerard Butler, and then
the Jean Cocteau arms.
Well, somewhere there's a lonely Colin Farrell because Horse shows up. This is the best thing. Okay, outside of the
where?
Color
where?
That's because he's black. He's a black horse, so he's just a magical Wizard of Oz horse is what we've learned from this, because he has a completely different color.
That's
now,
exactly what we said too, Patty and I were, where'd he get a horse? And
which
then
is in the book.
And then when he gets her in the gondola and they're going to go take their little gondola ride through the sewers of Paris, the horse is gone. Just disappeared. Yep.
Well, even the horse was like, I'm not going to go wading through shit water.
Why would I do that? That's disgusting. Ew.
Yeah. Anyway, I got to go help this poor young man who's just murdered his lover with his penis. I'll be back.
I almost spit out my drink.
I'll say this, though. You're talking about how the crazy, over-the-top quality of what Gerard Butler does in this song, singing the Phantom of the Opera. This is absolutely on point with what the musical version of this sounds like.
Yeah, it's very over-the-top. It's just, he's more screamy.
Yeah.
Than Michael Crawford is, for
sure.
He
seems to be screaming it more, and his physicalness is like all over the place.
I think physicality.
Yeah, that's what it is. That's
yes.
What it is.
Okay.
Oh, listen, which by the way, sorry.
Some slack. I had no power. I forgot how things work.
Yes, I did. So I told Nathan about this offline. However, I thought you would love to know this. Have you seen the list of the potential other Phantoms that were in talks?
Please tell me Sean Connery was on the list.
No. But we got some better ones. Okay, so Antonio Banderas was like the big one that they were thinking of looking at.
Oh, I know of one. I know of one. I know Hugh Jackman almost did it.
That wasn't the list that I saw, but that does make sense for this time. But yeah, I have to go back to my pages. So we got John Travolta.
Whoa.
We got Meatloaf.
What?
We got Heath Ledger, which is the most reasonable choice.
I could see that.
And I saved my favorite for last.
Gary Busey.
God. Matthew McConaughey.
Oh my god.
Or as I like to call him, all right, okay, yo, sure.
He's way all too chill.
Right?
I can't see him losing his mind on the regular in this movie the way Gerard Butler does.
No. Man, I remember when he loses his mind in Dark Tower, and I was like, this doesn't feel right.
No.
What's he going to be, like, singing about being the Phantom in the middle of doing bong rips? Like,
well, I mean, he could do a whole song about how he's a dwarf, too. Fucking tiptoes.
Oh my god, I forgot about tiptoes.
You know what I like about Christine, man? She gets older and I stay the same age.
He's not
that
wrong.
Is wild. I want to see the John Travolta version right now.
Right.
But yes.
Yeah, so he would have brought the insanity for sure.
He's singing the Phantom of the Opera song. He's singing Music of the Night. Of course, that's the other. I would say those two are the two, like, big numbers from this that everyone knows. You know,
absolutely.
Nighttime sharpens. Na, 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 na,
there's a reason I had to do this song in eighth grade band. This is how I found out about this. We played this song, and, like, it works when it's sung. But when you have to play that song and it's just da 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 for like 5 minutes, you're like, can I please play something else now? I'm tired.
At this point, there was just a quick shot of Christine's face, and she had this befuddled look on her face. Oh. And I imagined her saying, "You're Scottish, aren't you?"
Right? Your face looks like you keep wanting to do your Scottish brogue, but you're trying to force it not to.
I know right. We're in France, and I'm supposed to be the daughter of a Swede, but you're Scottish, aren't you?
Also, the Phantom has more candles in that room than an In Excess video. There are so many candles.
Or meatloaf.
Yeah, or meatloaf.
Speaking of those damn candles, it's so ridiculous because they come out of the water.
That's how, flame and water, they go hand in hand.
Clearly they're gas-powered candles.
The thing that's weird about those candles is that is in the show of, like, there's some candelabras that, like, rise from the floor, and it works because it's, like, it's a transition, you know, that thing that shows have sometimes.
In theater.
Yes. So having it just be like, oh, yeah, no, he has these magical candles that can, like, magically light themselves when they hit air. Just like, I think Andy forgot what transitions were and was like, yeah, this is how that was a thing.
No, but this actually goes back to what I was saying. I said this to Brendan as well because he was delighting in everybody's over the top rendition of every song and all their movements. And I said, I feel like, yeah, it's a film, but they shot it like, make sure everyone in the back row sees you too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's almost like when you watch a movie from like the early days of sound, and it's like, oh, these are stage actors. Like these are not, people are not used to being in a movie yet.
Right.
I gotta say too, so I'm sure we're gonna mention this at some point, so it's good to mention it now. Emmy Rossum was 17 when she shot this movie, making a lot of these scenes, much like last week's movie, kind of disturbing when Gerard Butler is holding her, getting a handful of boob and getting very handsy and putting her hands all over his face and all this stuff.
Yep.
But I did say it's okay because it's the 19th century France. Which, that makes it okay, right?
The actor is 17.
Well, if we learned anything from Winter's Tale, it's that giant age gaps in romantic relationships is A-okay.
But at least that girl was over 18.
She was 20. Yeah, she's like 20.
But yeah, so he does this. She sees a bridal gown and rightfully passes the fuck out. She's like, what the hell?
Well, it's a bridal gown that looks like her. It's on a mannequin that looks like her. That's why she freaks out.
The stalker of the opera.
That's actually Emmy Rossum in a bunch of makeup. Fun fact. They just made her look like a wax figure, and they're like, okay, now stay very still.
Sounds more like an interesting tidbit to me, if you ask, but...
Sounds like a tidbit that's interesting. Mm-hmm. The Phantom puts her in bed and creepily slinks away, and I was like, yikes, 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 yikes. The cut to the next scene. I just noted this guy was the Teamster dude, just the guy hanging out.
Oh, Raptors. Joseph.
Yeah, but he just seems to
Joseph
be like he's just a guy that would wear one of those belts with like a bunch of tools on it and shit. But he's
a stagehand. Yeah.
Yeah. He's Teamster.
Chief of the flies. Oh,
he's singing to the ladies about the Phantom, and he's like, you know, it's a big scary monster, and then. Fucking Madame Giry is like, keep your hands to yourself, you creep. Like, there's a lot of French perverts in this movie.
Which, can we point out...
I think you could have just didn't have to add in this movie, and I would have believed you.
In many ways, Miranda Richardson is the Jerry Orbach of this whole thing, where it's like, she's the only person doing a French accent, and everybody else is like, fuck, I'm going to do whatever I want, I don't care.
Everybody's alarmingly British or UK, except for Patrick Wilson. Yeah,
and Patrick Wilson is just straight up doing his regular voice.
Yeah,
with a little more flavor, like a little bit of salt in it, but it's mostly just his voice.
I think it was probably a Kevin Costner Prince of Thieves situation where he was like, "You probably wouldn't have liked my other accent."
Yeah,
it was not good, dog.
Christine wakes up in perfect makeup and sings about her encounter with the Phantom. And Sharon, she takes off his half mask. And this is the scene that you said you really like.
Yes, I love this scene.
Does he react sensibly to this?
Yes, he does, Brendan. He, in fact, acts the way any normal person would if he ripped a mask off, which is he starts yelling at her and saying, "Curse you, you little lying Delilah." Which,
you little viper, I know this, now you cannot ever be free.
Yes. Which
is that what I you know, wanted to see, you little viper?
Yes. I am aware that I am, in fact, on a video call, and this is a podcast, and nobody can see the little head bob that I was doing, but I feel like it's very important to explain to you the physicality.
Happens all the time on our show.
Every single time I talk about that part, I do the little head bob that he does. He's just like, I loved this so much that I sent it to Brendan. I was like, Brendan, this is what you have to look forward to. This is going to be great. Because it's the best part. I said, this is where he peaks and he does not get any better than this.
But second to that is immediately after his little freak out is when he basically calmly looks at Christine and says, "Okay, well, we better get you back. They're going to start looking for you."
Come, we must return.
Bloop, 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 please love me. And then he's like, "Okay, I'm fine now. Let's go upstairs."
Yeah.
Everything's fine now.
We go back to the future where black and white existed.
During that last scene, by the way, before we go, you know, into the 1900s, Patty was even like, "He needs to calm down."
Oh, yeah.
Even Patty, like one who just randomly quips about our stuff that we watch, she was like, "Chill out, Phantom."
Again, this again further proves the theory that Patty is in fact my mother, because again, in the video I sent to Brendan, my mom was also watching this with me, and she's like, "He has that temper. What is wrong with him?"
Well, I'm not gonna deny she's got pretty big mom energy.
She does have that mom energy.
A BME,
going on. BME, yeah. So back to back to 1917 Paris in black and white, and just ever so briefly, it's really not much of anything. We just get a little more fervent stares.
Actually, every time they did this thing, my note is, back to 1917, turn tape over, because I had the soundtrack for this on cassette, like the original London recording.
Yeah, well, it always bothers me too, because that framing device isn't there. Like, it's the opening part is there in the stage show, but it feels like they're like, "Well, this is weird that this is here, because we don't really need it, so like, let's keep that and then just add more to justify it."
It's completely unnecessary. You could just have the story without any of that. But and it spoils it if you've never seen it before, I guess, right? Kind of.
What, that Christine is dead or that the Phantom?
Well, I don't know.
Which just, part?
Like, I don't know. I feel like when they do that kind of wraparound device, it's like, "Oh, okay, so I'm not worried about this character's fate then, because I know they're
fine." That was tacked on entirely for the movie, though.
That's what I mean, though. I'm watching the movie, and I'm like, "Oh, okay, so I know they're going to be fine."
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, you know Raul's going to be fine, and...
everybody else who knows.
Meg's mom is fine, but everybody else is up for grabs.
Yeah, but Raul is, like, one of the ones that's threatened with death the most.
Fair.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so... After we have that ever so quick scene in 1917, we go back to the two owners, Furman and Andre. They're singing a bunch about the Phantom. They start getting letters. They get a letter that he's like, he wants his 20,000 francs. There's a letter that says he doesn't like Carlotta. He's complimenting Christine. He's threatening Raoul, telling him to never see Christine again. He warns Carlotta that a great misfortune will occur if she tries to take Christine's place. And there's a letter saying that he wants them to cast Christine in the main role and Carlotta as the page boy because she has no lines.
I'm saying all this in my head.
Sick.
Yep. Burn. Yeah, I did. Yep, I did the exact same thing, because again, a lot of the letters, they just speak and they are supposed to be sung. And they even, the thing that kills me about it too, is they have the track underlining the spoken dialogue too. So like, was it your days at the Opera Populaire are numbered? And like, you can hear that whole, you can hear the whole underscore that's supposed to be playing during that part. And they just speak it and it's like, no, this would
have
sound.
Have nerve to send this.
I think
someone with a pure brain. These are both signed OG. Who the hell is he?
Opera ghost.
Sorry. I think my favorite part of that whole thing is after he sends all those letters of like threats, it says, your obedient servant, OG.
OG.
Obedient? You're literally in command of everyone. There's nothing obedient about you.
Well, that was a way that they signed letters for a long time. Because if you look at Alexander Hamilton and Aaron Burr's letters, they also signed, like, I have the honor to be your obedient servant, A.Ham, A.Burr, whatever.
But so, it should have said, your absolute master, the opera singer, the Phantom of the Opera, not the opera singer. Somebody moons the camera for no reason at all.
They hate any driver. That's why.
Yep. And then we get a lot of this musical number where they're basically kissing Carlotta's ass, talking about how great she is because they don't want her to quit. They want her to stay with the opera. I'm assuming.
Oh, and she's also casting blame on Raul for all of this.
Saying that
too.
He did it. Yeah.
So why do they? So do they keep? Do they want to keep her because she's rich? Is that what? Or she's famous? Like what?
She's famous.
I don't know why. Why are they begging her to stay?
Well, so in the stage show, also this part, the whole part of them kissing her ass, like, does make sense. Because she's like, they're like, your public needs you, and we need you, too. And, but in the movie,
would you
it
rather
does
not
make,
have your petite ingenue?
Your precious little ingenue. Anyway, but in the stage, we don't know what the general public thinks at all. We assume that it is, in fact, like, yes, they love Carlotta. Like, yeah, Christine was cool or whatever. But, like, they want Carlotta back. But in the movie, they distinctly have that one extra that's like, can you give this flower to Christine Daae, please? So, like, so when they say your public needs you, it's like, are we just ignoring the fact that clearly all these fans want to see Christine and not her? Like, we're just going to ignore that? Whatever. Whatever, bitch. Okay.
She also gets, like, major, like, billing on the poster. Because as they're coming in, it's like, there's Hannibal. But it's like starring La Carlotta. So, I mean, she is at the very least supposed to be, in the parlance of the wrestling, a box office draw.
She's the Ric Flair of this show.
Yeah. Well, actually, like she's more the Hulk Hogan, John Cena trying to bury the younger talent.
True. Oh, that, come on. Hulk Hogan, I'll give you.
Oh, Cena versus the NXT, anybody?
I don't think it's entirely him, according to everyone else that was involved in this.
Saying he went along with it.
Anyway, so she is
a box office draw. She's famous. That's why they want to keep her. It's like, we paid for Carlotta, or we're paying I don't know if it would be like a retainer or a salary because she's like an in-house artist. Mm-hmm. We're paying for that. We want to use her because otherwise, you know, we're giving her money to do nothing.
And then at one point during that whole musical number, Furman does his best Quentin Tarantino impression.
He sniffs her shoe and all of which my father came in the middle of watching this part and he was like, what is happening? Why is he smelling her shoe? Also, he was like, ew, Ciaran Hinds is not singing well. Like, wow. He's not doing a good job, which... He's not wrong, but
honestly, I have a hard time judging. Unless they're intentionally doing a horrible job, it's really hard for me to tell.
Right.
But show goes on. The show starts. The Phantom at some point switches out Carlotta's water spray.
Right.
At first, I thought it was perfume, by the way. It's the when she sprayed it into her mouth, I was like, what?
Ew. Yeah.
Like Primatine mist.
Yes.
Yeah. So this he switches it out with something. And, oh, it turns out to be something that makes her lose her voice. And she's like, doing the whole thing. Yeah.
Yeah, which I think this is also a very good example of the movie is constantly, like, removing mystique that the stage show had. Because you don't know, like, because when he's like, did I not instruct that box 5 was to be kept empty? Like, when that happens and he says, like, she's like, you have popped a silent little toad. And he's like, a toad, madam, perhaps it is you that are the toad. And she starts croaking. You don't know what's going on.
Right.
Like, you don't know. Well, they don't include the spray thing in the stage show, for one.
It sounds like what you're saying, Sharon, is that this movie is spelling it out all, like, as if we're a bunch of idiots.
Yeah, a little bit. But also, like, the way that I always kind of saw that played, well, or at least a thing that I think is more interesting, is that possibly, maybe what could be happening is that, she's like, I'm not afraid of some phantom. I don't know who the fuck that is. But, like, subconsciously, she's freaking the fuck out. And so when her voice cracks, it's like a psychological thing.
Oh.
So you can play it that way because there's enough freedom to do so. But if you spell it out like this, you have a definitive answer, and not everyone's going to like that definitive answer.
You don't have to worry because Joseph Bouquet is on the case.
Yep. And
played by Steve Bannon, by the looks of it.
He's played by the guy from the Pirates of the Caribbean movies.
So Steve Bannon.
Yes. Yes, he looks like if Nick Offerman drowned.
So because of all this, they're like, well, shit, we better act fast. So they get Christine to play the role at the last second. And they're all like, but until we get this figured out, here's a random ballet from Act 3 to kill time.
Yep.
Yes. Which, like, it does work in the stage show because, like, again, you're not seeing all the creepy shit that's happening backstage. Yeah. It's just kind of like, oh, yeah, this weird creepy thing happened. But, like, it's okay. We're just going to make you forget about it by having this pastoral ballet thing happen, which is fine. And then, like, weird creepy shit happens. And, again, having him, the Phantom, be the aggressor in this situation is kind of like, because, again, you could be like, you don't know specifically what happened. You could be like, well, maybe Bouquet was just in the wrong place at the wrong time and he had to kill him. Maybe Bouquet was being the aggressor in this situation and it was an accident. You don't know. So being like, oh no, he actually was like, the Phantom was full on the aggressor in this situation. And also being like, bleh, 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 I'm going to get you.
There's no ambiguity here. Like, no, Johnny Sumster.
So, what you're saying is the Phantom is if Gene Belcher played the Phantom.
Yes.
Like, Johnny Keemster.
I would watch that.
Johnny Keemster is in the rafters and literally, like, oh, well, I better stop that Phantom. He seems like, you know, I got to catch that wascally Phantom. And yeah, the Phantom hangs him from his neck in the middle of the performance. If anything, I would think that the Phantom of the Opera would not want to interrupt a performance like that. He seems like a professional up until that point. And then it's like, dude, you love the theater. Why would
he's
you do this?
Like, he's also mad. Like spasming the whole time. And it's very upsetting in a way where it's just like, oh yeah, like, because it's not a real person on the stage show. It's just like, oh look, there's a dummy in the background now. So like, but like, it's just too much. It's just too much. It's too much.
Well, and they don't. And then everyone recovers from this fairly quickly. Like, yeah.
I don't know. Christine and Raul flee to the roof.
But I mean, they're not like, holy shit, a person just died. He's more like, oh, my love, why aren't you with me? And I think shortly after this, they have their first kiss, like right away.
Their
almost.
Big romantic love duet.
Their
yeah.
Big romantic. You know, it's that. Well, I feel like this is what happens when
finds out behind a horse's ass.
I feel like this is what footage of Leo DiCaprio when he started dating his first girlfriend.
Yeah,
he dated her for 8 years, and then that's it.
Lease is up.
25, you're done.
Yeah. Which, by the way, again, this whole scene of that having the romantic love duet. They just love undercutting themselves in this movie so much because, again, in the stage show, the whole, like, Christine being up there with Raul and being like, I feel bad for the Phantom, even though he just did some murder, maybe, possibly, I don't know.
Because the ambiguity's not there, so it's like, no, how can you feel bad for him, you weirdo? Yes.
Well, and the big thing that I'm sure Nathan will explain as well, or knows what I'm talking about, is that, so she says, he says her name. Raul says, like, Christine, and then you hear Christine, and she's like, ah, what was that? And, like, they don't address it until the very end when he shows up. And it's like, oh, he was actually up here the whole time. Like, you don't know if Christine's losing her mind or if the Phantom actually is up there. So when they have him say that, like, there's no tension there because they keep cutting back to him every single time.
There's supposed to be a better reveal, that's for sure.
Yeah, we see that he's there, and it's like, okay.
He can't take this. He's quite upset by this whole thing about
I'm assuming he's just like me, where he says, like, sir, she's far too young for you. I'm assuming that's what it is, right? Because
but he's older than the V-Comp.
By about 4 years, yeah. They don't just have a peck either. Yep. It's like a full-on, like, mash-em-up, like...
Yes, because they were childhood sweethearts.
That's terrible.
I hate that phrase so much.
I was 14, he was 27. It was so romantic.
It was, you know, that's what childhood sweethearts are. At least one of you has to be a child.
I think Sharon just got temporarily replaced by the founder of Nambla for a second there. Nambla, yeah.
It couldn't be any worse than, like, was it Jerry Prager, whatever the fuck his name was, who's like,
oh,
fuck, what was it?
Jerry Sandusky.
No, I was thinking of one of the guys in charge of Prager U was like, I don't understand what's wrong with having sex with, like, if a brother and a sister want to have sex, that's fine. Is it, if, like, you know, like.
Charles Prager said that?
Yes, he was like. It's like, I don't understand what's wrong with incest. If a brother and a sister want to have sex, that's fine. Like, if it's because they'll be, like, if they'll have deformities or they'll be, like, on the spectrum, who cares? That won't happen for, like, a while. And it's like, I thought that everybody realized that the way to discourage incest is because it's incest and that's your brother, my dude.
This episode has taken a turn.
Well,
anyway,
getting back to the movie that thankfully doesn't include any incest, but does include a lot of unhealthy, weird relationships. The Phantom sings and cries after seeing this kiss, not understanding anything, but yells that they will curse the day that they did not obey his rider contract.
Yes.
And I'm assuming this is where the intermission would go, because it was very much like an intermission break.
Yes.
Yes. Yep. And this is also where the
flash forward put in the other tape.
Yes.
Yes.
And this is where we get our ad for Swarovski crystals, because again,
for just a brief second, yeah, I did see that. Yes.
And the reason I figured this out finally, I was like, why is that ad there? They're in there because they're the reason the chandelier looks the way that it is. They gave them, like, all the crystals that are in the chandelier are Swarovski crystals, so that's why there's an ad for Swarovski crystals in the middle, and it's like, okay.
Well, you got to pay the bills, right? So we're in 1917 again. Old Raoul remembers himself kissing that child. I mean, Christine. cut back to 1870 again. It's time for a masquerade, masquerade.
Paper faces on parade, masquerade.
The most boring masquerade. Hide your face
so the world will never find you.
The most boring masquerade, because all of the costumes are just black and white and gold, and that is it. Which, like, just look up photos or watch the 25th anniversary concert of what those costumes look like. They're incredibly colorful. Like, Christine has, like, this beautiful, like, tutu on. One of them has, like,
I think this is probably more of a Schumacher decision than anything
else. It must have been. Because they had a $70 million budget, which is more than the actual stage show had at the time. Like, this, at the time, the stage show in 2004 money had an equivalent of, like, $12 million. So they had significantly more money.
You know what's weird, though? You say it must be a Joel Schumacher thing, but Joel Schumacher is known for his coloring up movies. Like, look at Batman Forever. Look at Batman and Robin. That's kind of wild to me.
I just mean just going in the opposite direction of the source material.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, that was my biggest problem with Phone Booth. There was nothing like the novella.
Okay.
Okay.
It's not based on anything. but it does have a man in the movie who killed a girl with his dick. So, back to this movie. Yeah, the masquerade is happening. Raoul and Christine are having a secret engagement. And when I laughed.
Your future bride.
Well, I laughed really.
But why is it secret? What have we to hide? I'm sorry.
I was going to say, I laughed really hard because he said, it's an engagement. Why are we hiding it? It's an engagement, not a crime. And I said, well, almost. Almost.
Again, 19th century France. Probably not a crime then.
Yeah. Also, they then dance and then they kiss in the middle of the dance floor. And I'm like, I thought you guys said it was a secret. Why are you kissing in the middle of the dance floor? Nobody's there.
Secret engagement, not a secret
romance.
Fuck buddy. Yeah, that's a nicer
way to say it. Sure, let's go with that.
But and of course they're all like, well, certainly the Phantom will not show up at this thing. Never, no way. Uh-oh, the room goes dark and the Phantom is there and he looks like some sort of bedazzled pirate with his red costume.
He's supposed to be the Mask of the Red Death.
Yes.
Okay. I bought it.
Did you have more?
He's wearing the full mask the Red Death, and didn't the original London production have not a full mask, but like, you know, like a full mask over most of the face of the Phantom? It was the New York one that did the half mask, wasn't it?
No. So the original,
but that's on the cover of the CD.
So that is because they had the poster for the artwork finished before they actually finished the half mask. And part of why they did that was because they couldn't figure out how to get the mask to work with the microphone. So they just sort of
did the half mask.
The mask. Yeah.
Okay.
So they did that in London and in New York.
Oh, okay. Okay.
But the mask for the red mask, or the Mask of the Red Death. Yes, the Mask of the Red Death costume is just like, it fully covers his face. And he's just like a skeleton that looks like its mouth is moving, which is like legit creepy. And in this, it's just like, oh, his mask kind of looks like a skeleton, but it looks like it's actually covering up less of his face than the other one, which is already smaller than this one. Like, this version of the mask is even smaller than the stage show version, because the stage show version is almost entirely half of his face and even like a little over half of his forehead. And in this one, it's just like, no, we need to see Gerard's face because he's...
you pay for Gerard Butler, you use Gerard Butler.
You use the face.
But don't worry,
but don't worry, guys. He's not there for fightings. He's just there to deliver the score for a new opera, Don Juan Triumphant. And then he starts fat shaming the lead actor. He tells Carlotta that she needs to learn how to act. Says that Christine must wash away her pride and return to him as her teacher so he can perfect her skills as a singer. This all leads to a mirror fight with Raoul and the Phantom, where he attempts to have a sword fight with him.
In a hall of mirrors.
Yes.
Hall of mirrors.
Yes, which is a thing from the book. He does mention, it is mentioned in the stage show too, that he once built for the Shah of Persia a maze of mirrors, but obviously because they couldn't do that in the stage version, they're like, let's put it in the movie. And it's like, well,
okay.
What was the
He built it for the Shah, not for the opera.
Yeah. Yep. Do we want to talk about his backstory now? Cause we're going to get into that.
Well,
oh, yes, yeah,
we're going to have to, obviously.
Well, yeah, because Madame Jury...
I'm saying we
want
to do that now.
So Madame Jury tells the story to Raoul. She's with a traveling band of people, and they found this boy with a hood over his head or something being tortured, and eventually eventually the boy killed the torturer, and Jury helped him flee. She hit him in the opera house. Boom, ba, boom. He's the Phantom, an architect, a designer, a genius.
I like the way the Phantom was handled in the Robert Englund version, because in that, he makes a deal with the devil.
Yep.
And because he wants to be known for his music, and the devil's fine. You'll be known for your music, but that's all you'll be known for. And he scars his face, and that's why he wears the mask.
Yeah.
And, not because he's some freak child who garrots a Romani captor.
Yeah, which, by the way, that man is just giving the performance of a lifetime, because as he's picking up the money, he does this weird thing where he just starts wagging his tongue, and he's like, yes, money, 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 money. And it's like...
Yeah, it's like
he just went ham.
I noticed, like, oh my God, it's Sid Haig and Dee Snider.
Yeah, he was so ridiculously over the top about money. It was like a 1940s propaganda film out of Europe or something.
Right? Yeah. And it's also weird because they mention in this one that she's like, oh yes, after he did that murder, I've been hiding him in the opera house this whole time, which doesn't explain anything, because it's like, because how is he able to do all of this amazing stuff since he was a child? Because again, in the book and in the stage show, it's like, he's been, like, all over the place. He's been to Persia, which is Iran now. Like, he's been to Italy. He's been all over Europe and Asia. So, like, he's learned all this stuff because of traveling, and he's only been at the opera for, I don't know, maybe 10 years, maybe 5 at most. So it's kind of weird that they're like, oh, yeah, he's been in the opera for like 20, 30, 40, however old Gerard Butler's supposed to be years.
Well, he is supposed to have taught a young childhood-aged Christine Daae how to sing. So,
yeah. So it's a little
weird. Which puts a whole, Electra complex thing on the relationship that he wants out of her.
Yeah.
Also, Nathan, how much did you enjoy that her last name was also the name of the production company that makes the Gamera movies?
Daae?
Pretty close.
It's pretty close, yeah. It is. I never thought of that until just now.
So Christine is like going to visit her father's grave. She takes a carriage, but unbeknownst to her, the Phantom just clubs the driver and takes his place. Raoul sees all this and he's like, oh shit, I gotta get on my horse. Is it a magic horse? We don't know.
She is wearing sexy lingerie, as it appears to be. Like, it's the weirdest outfit that she's wearing here.
Oh, I mean, she's going to the cemetery. You got to look your best.
Yeah, for all the dead people.
Right.
Obviously.
Christine.
Maybe she just doesn't care what she wears when she's around.
Look, just because they're corpses doesn't mean I have to look like a corpse.
Obviously. Anyway, continue.
Christine shows up and starts singing about her dead dad. He's super dead. And then the Phantom joins in, wandering child, whatever he sings. Raoul interrupts this seduction, though, to warn Christine that this man, this thing, this Phantom is not an angel sent by her father. It's not her father's angel. He's a murderer. He's a crazy person.
He's just some dude.
Yeah, he's just some dude. He's like, this 30-year-old isn't good for you. This 30-year-old is. And they have a sword
fight.
Don't
let him be creepy and possessive. Let me be creepy and possessive.
Right.
They have a sword fight for a while. Raoul gets the Phantom down and seemingly is about to deliver the death blow. But Christine stops him at the last second for reasons.
She's like, no, not like this. And it's like, not like this. What do you mean? And it's like, well, we need the plot to continue to happen. And you're like, oh, okay.
Her whole thing the whole time is like, he taught me how to sing. It's like, great. But he also murdered several people. I think it's okay to just kill him.
Yeah.
Also, he probably did stuff to you while you were passed out, dressed up in a wedding dress that he took off of a dummy that kind of looks like you.
Oh, for sure. He did. Mm-hmm. He definitely did. But
some light touching. We'll call it that.
Some over the clothes touching. Yeah. Christine does end up leaving with Raoul, and the Phantom of course says, now let it be war upon you both, as they're leaving on the magical horse. So now it's time for a plan. We got to get this Phantom. We're going to prepare this musical. We're going to do the musical he wants us to do, Don Juan triumphant, but we're going to catch the Phantom. We're going to kill him.
Cops are going to be there.
What?
Yeah.
The cops are going to be there.
Oh, I think so. We're going to cut off his head.
No, not yet. No. Also, which one?
Both. At the same time. Christine is a little worried about being used as bait, which is a fair sentiment.
Yes.
But Rule is like, listen, don't worry about him. He's just a man. He's not magic or anything. He's not a devil. He's not an angel. He's just a man. And I'm like, there's been some things he's done where I've questioned if he's just a man, but okay. So they start the play. They start the opera, rather. There is police presence on hand.
But I'm sure they'll be so much help.
Oh, and they are immediately, because the Phantom just casually shows up and I think kills the guy, right?
Yeah, almost as soon as he gets off the stage, he's like, bye-bye, I'm going to wear a different costume from what you were wearing. It's just so bizarre, too, because, like, his mask is even smaller than before. So it's like, how bad can the deformity be?
You know what also is smaller than before? The person in that role.
That makes no sense. Anyway, but...
It shrunk because he realized he wasn't going to get laid that night. Yes.
And it's also weird because, like, in the stage show, the way that they, like, move this around is that Pianji is wearing a costume where you cannot see his face. Like, his face is completely covered. And so that's how you can be like, oh, yeah, sure, of course she doesn't know that it's Phantom. Because it doesn't look... Because she doesn't know. She can't see his face. And then when he shows up, it's like, wait, what? He wants to star in his Don Juan fanfic.
So, I mean, eventually she's like, okay, so the Phantom's coming. So I was confused about this. Yes, so he doesn't look anything like that guy, obviously, in height, weight, build, nothing. But was there a plan that he would knowingly get himself involved in the play? Because when he does it, this is the only reason I'm saying it, because when he does it and he's coming over Christine, he's singing the part. We cut to Raul, like Patrick Wilson, and he's given the signal, like, almost ready, almost good to go. I'm like, was this their plan?
I don't think this is entirely their plan. They just knew that the Phantom would insert himself into this play or this show in some way, shape, or form.
Oh, okay. Yeah, so they figured he would become an actor in the opera.
Or at least make an appearance by, like, messing with the show or killing somebody. Or at the very least, showing up in box five.
Yeah, just messing up in some way.
Because it was weird. I was like, wait, not only did they use Christina's bait, did they use that other actor's bait to
know
murder him? I know that's not what it's supposed to be, but that's how it comes across.
Yeah, that's not the initial plan, especially because, again, we don't see a whole lot in the stage show. It's just like, oh yeah, like Pianji goes off stage, Christine shows up, and then someone says master, and he says Pasadino, and that's when you realize, oh shit, Pianji's dead. Like, that's when you're like, oh, shit, he's dead. Like, they're trying to be as prepared for the whole thing as much as possible.
Yeah, I just felt like the execution was weird of this whole
thing. It's a little bot, yeah.
But she's starting to fall for this gosh darn murder and phantom again. And before they can really take action, they go right through the stage, down, down, down into the catacombs, into the basement. Because down we plunge to the prison of my mind.
Do we want to talk about the most important thing, though, which is that we see his... No, the deformity.
But the
chandelier.
Before that, I should mention the chandelier does crumble, because that was an important part at the beginning. There's a fire. And
he cuts the weight, and it, like, just basically shreds the roof and falls on into the audience.
Yes, and then he takes his mask off, revealing a hideous visage. Actually, it's one of the least ugliest phantoms I've ever seen.
Yeah, it's not. It's even stupider than him not being deformed at all, which is what Dario Argento did.
Lon Chaney Jr., that's for sure.
Nope. Oh. And, oh gosh, what was it? Which I have, I take umbrage with the way that they destroy the opera house, because in the opening, it's just kind of like, oh, it looks like it's just been abandoned for a while. But they go out of their way to be like, after he destroys the chandelier and it falls into the audience, like, a bunch of shit gets caught on fire, and it looks like nothing is singed at all in the original. So I wonder if they just added that later, because they're like, we don't have enough money to make this look like it's been on fire. I don't know.
If you want to know how to take down a movie house, you contact Shoshana. She'll show you how to do it. Inglourious Bastards.
Okay.
Gotcha. Oh, sorry. It's been so long, I forgot. But yeah, it's
Shoshana!
Been...
Yeah, so they plunge into the, you know, prison of his mind. Rahul starts chasing them, but he falls through a trap door into the water. Don't worry. He's going to be fine. The Phantom is puts on like her wedding gown and her ring, but she's like, no, your soul is full of distortion. This is no good. They're singing all this. Don't worry about it.
I love the line where he's like, this face, the infection, which poisons our love. When he says that line, she kind of looks at, there are two things. One, she looks at him like, bitch, are you serious? Like, you just got stung by a bee. You're fine. Or he rubbed fish on his face, either or. And my other favorite thing is when I watched it the second time around, I was like, this is a very Edward Cullen, like, this is the skin of a killer, Bella, kind of reaction. Oh, of like, God. I'm ugly. Don't look at me. Don't look at me. I'm not pretty.
If only he sparkled. If only he sparkled.
It would honestly make the movie better.
So... at this point, Raul does reach the gate. He reaches the gate right on the other side of where the Phantom and Christine are. And the Phantom lets him right in. But then he starts wrapping this rope around Raul's hands. And he says, all right, Christine, you got a couple choices here. You can be with me and tell me you love me and I won't kill Raul. Or you know what? You can not be with me and I'll kill Raul. Tough choice. What are you going to do?
It's so difficult.
Ask, she show some compassion. This world show no compassion to me.
Right.
They just did because they could have killed you in the graveyard earlier.
Yeah.
And they didn't.
But you didn't.
So he's like, all right, time to nut up or shut up. Again, a Joel Schumacher thing, Batman Forever. Remember, guys, that classic scene? He had to choose between Robin or his girlfriend. It's the same thing going on. So he has to choose, and she has to choose, and ultimately she's like, okay, yeah, I love you, Phantom, and they make out, you know.
And then another... he starts crying, which my favorite line that Lindsay Ellis said about this in one of her videos is, she goes, I'm glad you could kiss me despite my pink eye.
Now she's gonna get pink eye,
obviously. Anyway, sorry, continue.
Yeah, well, just as she makes out with him and he starts crying and he's like, no, just take your Raul and get out of here, let me die, it's over, the music of the night, and he starts like smashing his mirrors and shit,
his metaphorical mirrors. Metaphor.
Yeah, she's also like, here's your ring back that you like gave me and stuff.
Or whatever. Oh, yeah,
that was so funny because they leave, like her and Raul seemingly leave, and then she's suddenly just like standing there and she's like, hey, me again, Christine. And I'm like, get out of there. He gave you a fucking out. Leave.
Yeah.
She's like, yeah, here's your ring. I guess we could have been something special. And
bye. Yeah.
That is in the stage show too.
It's crazy though.
Which is, yeah, it's a lot.
So, but she has to do it in order to put the button on the movie at the end.
Right, yep. Right. She gives it to him, and then we don't really full on see what happened to him, right? But we cut back to the black and white.
Meg finds
The mask.
The mask.
Right.
And the monkey playing the cymbals.
And she puts it on and she's like, smoking.
Kennedy.
Oh, God. Okay, avoid like the plague. You've made my decision.
Oh, God. I remember that movie. That movie is like nightmarish and not in a
coming
fun way.
Soon. I got to watch that at some point.
Oh, no. I'm so sorry.
But back to the futuristic black and white of 1917, we see that Raul is leaving flowers for Christine, who died in 19... Oh, sorry, this is 1919. I believe she died in 1917.
Yeah.
And that's the fucking movie.
No, yeah. It's not, because he puts the monkey with the symbols on her grave and then just notices just off to the left, there's a rose with the ring that she gave back to the Phantom.
And a black ribbon, because that is the perfect gift that everybody wants.
I would have loved to see old Raoul and find out that the Phantom is an old man and still alive, and they had like an old man sword fight.
Get over here!
Which I loved. I ended up like watching the credits because I was like finishing my notes up.
And so you were hoping there was a Marvel Universe after scene?
No. No, I did want to listen to Learn to Be Lonely because I hadn't heard it before. It sounds very much like a 1990s, 2004, like adult contemporary song, though. But you actually get to hear Minnie Driver's voice, which is very nice. And it bums me out that she doesn't get to actually sing for most of it.
I wonder though what the story behind that is. It might have been just something on her end where she wasn't, you know, maybe she had issues with her vocal cords or something.
Look, Minnie, your voice is just too nice for what we're going for.
It's too good. But my favorite thing is at the end of the credits, they have a couple of women that are just credited as ballet tarts.
Yeah.
And you're like,
I think those are the ones that Joseph was hitting on when Miss Geary was like, you shouldn't talk about things you know nothing about, Joseph Bouquet.
It's either that or they're the ones that when they see Raoul, they're like, he's a rich or whatever. I don't know.
That's a distinct possibility, yeah.
It could be them, I don't know.
Well, that is Phantom of the Opera 2004. So we will do what we usually do here as Nathan comes up his notes. Sharon, we'll start with you. So tell us, is this movie worth a watch? An inebriated in some form, a drunk watch, whatever, you know, whatever your choice is, pick your poison. Drunk watch with friends. Do you attempt head trauma to forget it or avoid like the plague?
I think it's worth the watch in some ways because even if it isn't necessarily good, like I think if you really, really love the Phantom show, it can be really frustrating. But there are other points where, like, when you just talk about it, it's just super fun. So I'm like, you know what? Like, I was going to say, like, only watch this if you're inebriated. But, like, I think if you have friends over, this would be fine, drunk or not.
And, Nathan, what about you?
I'm going to say drunk watch with theater friends.
There you go.
Because if I got, like, some of my, like, you know, football or video game friends to come over and get drunk and watch this, they'd be like, dude, what the fuck are we watching? So drunk watch with theater friends.
That's a good caveat.
I'm going to echo the drunk watch with friends. There are things in this movie that I do genuinely... There are a few things in this movie that I do genuinely like, but ultimately I was just entertained by the sheer like audacity of everything. Like it was just such a ridiculous spectacle. And the fact that it was directed by Joel Schumacher, just, I don't know. That's just a wonderful, wonderful choice. And have some drinks, like Nathan said, gather some theater friends and watch this thing.
That's also pretty like constrained on his part too, which is the funny part for me.
What?
How's it?
Like, I mean, like Joel's, like compared to his other movies, this is it's more constrained on his end. Like he doesn't go as over the top as I know.
Well, like because
it's boiling acid.
He probably had Andrew Lloyd Webber, you know, riding him the entire time, going, don't you ruin my show.
My shoes are melting.
Oh no, Batman! Yeah,
love that voice.
Batman!
Yeah. Sorry, bless you.
So, on that note, we are going to take a brief break and listen to some ads, and we will be right back.
What were they thinking?
NPR bot, please initialize.
Do, 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 do,
do. I can deal with that. Yes, I can deal with that. Less profanity than usual.
Right, exactly.
That's nice.
Yeah, well, it's of course it's time for the low haiku. Nathan, what is that?
Well, in case you're a first-time listener to our show, the low haiku is 17 perfect syllables that we use to describe the movie that we've been talking about for an indeterminate amount of time due to the amount of technical issues involved with this episode. Damn you, Mother Nature.
And everything else. Okay, so to start us off, Sharon, would you like to read your haiku?
Yes, thank you, Brendan. That's very nice of you. Okay. Excuse me. So sorry. My voice is getting tired now. Okay. The singing is meh. The scars are non-existent. Why are there floodlights?
Very good. Yes. Excellent. Excellent point.
Nathan, do you have a haiku for us as well?
Yes, I do. And it is with some of the more anachronistic inconsistencies with this movie.
Of which there are very few.
Scottish French phantom. A prima donna who can't sing. Wilson's hockey hair. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
All right, I have a haiku. You know, I'm gonna try to sing it. It doesn't quite fit, but it has the correct amount of syllables.
Okay.
Wintry settings, magical horses appear. Is this Winter's Tale?
Bring up some excellent points.
Thank you. And NPR bot, if you don't mind taking this out.
Beep boop, beep 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 boop, do dee do do.
I thought he was going to do the whole song. I got a little worried.
No, I mean the protocol itself is a pretty short program, so.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, yeah, we talked about this movie. We waxed poetic, but Nathan, what do we always tell the folks? We're not the kind to swing our egos all over the place.
No, not at all. It's so much so that we actually like to tell people to.
Don't take a word for us.
That's right. That's what we say. We say, hey, you there, you, the person walking. Hey, stop for a second. Yeah, don't take our word for it. Right?
Right. Yeah. No, that's what we say.
Well, but Nathan, surely it's a lavish musical, big production, big musical numbers, a show that everyone loves. Surely the critics had a good time with this one.
You would think that, but Joel Schumacher was involved. So only 33% of 170 reviews.
Oh, okay. Well, I mean, surely the audience was happier about it, but probably not by a whole lot.
Oh, they most certainly were. 84%. So audience-wise, this is whoppingly fresh. Out of 250,000-plus ratings, 84% of them were like, yeah, this is pretty cool.
This is up there with disparities between...
most definitely. But, I mean, if you did like this, mm-hmm. Which I... You know, I kind of did. You might also like Chicago.
Yeah, sure.
Makes sense. And
yeah.
Dirty Dancing. I mean, it certainly lends it to, you know, the star-crossed lovers thing, I guess. But
yeah.
Then we go into Bridget Jones and The Edge of Reason.
And weird, too, that they just picked, like, the second one.
Yeah. I Am Sam, starring Sean Penn, where he goes the full. That's all I'm saying. And finally... Memoirs of a Geisha.
Never seen.
No, me neither.
So. Perfect. So yeah, we've seen all those movies, and we all agree they all relate. Okay, well, let's get into the critics here. Okay, first one I got here is from Andrew Saris of The Observer. And Andrew Saris says, my own reaction to the current version fashioned by Mr. Schumacher is one of pure stupefaction.
Oh,
the negative review.
Okay, all right. Maddie Lucas from the
George's
Dispatch.
Daughter?
But I'm well, maybe.
Okay.
From the Dispatch out of Lexington, North Carolina, writes,
a solid retelling of the musical, giving Weber's wonderful music a chance to shine for a wider audience than they ever have before. And 3 out of 4 is what she gave on that.
Positive. Yeah. Okay.
Richard Probst of the Independent Critics said, "As I was sitting in the auditorium alone watching this film, I kept looking around hoping that there was a chandelier above me getting ready to plummet to the ground." He gave it 1.5 out of 4.
Oh, not a fan. Oh, Nathan, this is the place you keep telling me where that terrible massacre happened. Michael Compton of the Bowling Green Daily News.
Mm-hmm.
He says, "Rossum is a stunning beauty and very effective, but the movie's biggest problem is Butler. He comes off rather dull in a role that requires someone a lot more dynamic." I gotta say, you criticize as you want, but I would not, the criticism I would not use is dull.
No.
He
it might be too much.
It might be too much, exactly. He gives it his all and then some.
Well, my next one is from John Beefus. From the commercial appeal out of Memphis, Tennessee.
Mm-hmm.
And he writes, "Phantom calls himself a loathsome gargoyle, but unmasked, he looks more like a guy with a bad sunburn, or maybe seafood allergy. 1 out of 4.
Cole Smithy from colesmithy.com, he thought really hard about that website name, says, "Fans of musical theater will work themselves into a lather over Joel Schumacher's by-the-book film version of Andrew Lloyd Webber's monotonous play, but most audiences will either fall asleep or hit the cinema doors running." He gave that a D+.
Ooh, he came to play with that review.
Right?
All right, my last critic's one is from Russ Breimeyer of Christianity Today. "Most fans are bound to be disappointed to some degree, and non-aficionados of musical theater will find it tedious and silly. Do yourself a favor and see this on stage. Praise Jesus." I added that last part.
Okay. My last one comes from Ken Hankey of Asheville, North Carolina's Mountain Express.
Ooh.
And Ken liked this, really liked this, apparently, because his review snippet says, "It's one of those movies where I spent a lot of my first viewing thinking, yes, this is what movies are really all about. 5 out of 5.
Wow. That's so much. Oh, my God.
Ken, like,
even when I saw it, I don't know that I would have given it a 5 out of 5, but okay. Nick, and the last one is Nick Shaker. I don't know how to say his last name. I'm sorry. From Lessons of Darkness. Sure. Says, "Deserves to be locked up in a dank, water-filled dungeon and left to molder."
let's get into the audience reviews, the cream of the crop. Here we go. This one doesn't sound like anything special, but just wait. This is from Maelstrom E. Says, "I wanted to like it. I really did. It was one of my favorite musicals when I was a kid, and I was able to see a touring stage production. The best part about this movie is the trailer. The trailer made it look like the movie I wanted to see. The actual film just dawdled its way from start to finish." 3.5 stars.
Okay.
Didn't seem like a positive review, but...
Really undersold it until he got to the stars, eh?
Right.
Okay, well, my first one comes from Dick C., and I can only assume this Dick Clark.
Mm.
And he writes, "It's an excellent motion picture. The Phantom of the Opera, 2004 film, basing on the 1910 French novel Le Fantôme de l'Opéra by Gaston Leroux, and with the producer and co-writer Andrew Lloyd Webber's 1986 musical of the same name, an American co-writer and director Joel Schumacher supervises a good castings, especially Gerard Butler as the Phantom. ... 4.5 out of stars.
Wow.
I found one from Kaido O that says, "Absolutely stunning. This movie has opened my soul to musicals and theater. Thank you. 5 out of stars.
This one is from Jack D I can only assume Jack Donaghy from 30 Rock, Alec Baldwin's character. I am not doing the voice, though, because I will die. he says, having seen the play 5 times and loving it each and every time, I also had the pleasure of seeing it with Michael Crawford. It sounds like he saw it like with him, like he went with him to the play, who was astounding. Although I never completely understood every detail of the storyline until I saw the movie. The music was even better than the play. The characters are even better than the play. I fell in love with it all over again. 5 stars.
Wow.
Well, it makes sense that he understood it more because the movie spells out every single detail.
Okay, yeah. My next one comes from Robert P., and I can only assume that's Twilight's Robert Pattinson. And he writes, I know it was a musical, but I got tired of the same old music over and over again. 1.5 out of stars.
Oof.
Okay. I got one from
it
Rich S.
Sucked,
sorry.
Right?
Because you're like the vampire. Gotcha.
I want to suck your blood. Anyway. Rich S. says, it's been done and overdone and redone too many times. At the very least, a director has to make a classic like this better than the last one. 2.5 out of stars.
Okay.
All right. I've got one more for you. Now I don't know which one to do. I just saw another one. Okay, I've got one more for you from Charlotte K. Charlotte K says, great movie, my new favorite, dark, seductive, plus music and handsome men. 5 stars.
Okay, well, my last one comes from noted musical theater critic Spider K. And Spider writes, this movie has its moments of great acting and great singing, but it also has a really dull moments of which you can really get bored. Nevertheless, Gerard Butler, Emmy Rossum, and Patrick Wilson have good moments. 2.5 out of stars.
Okay.
Okay.
Go send us home.
Okay, last one I found is from Jesus H, but I'm gonna assume that it's Jesus H Christ.
I'm guessing so.
Yeah. For funnies.
Oh, my dad.
The collective singing was annoying, but the lead characters provided nice acting. The music is fine. The movie did feel a bit long. 4 out of stars.
The lead characters acted well.
Yes.
Well, there you go. Those are the reviews. That's what the critics are saying. That's what the people are saying. And we've said our piece. Black's poetic. I'm getting tired, guys.
long recording session.
It really
has. And for the most part, it hasn't been my fault this time.
No, it's mostly been, again, Mother Nature and NB Power.
And Lord Andy saying he doesn't want us to talk about this movie.
But what he does want us to talk about is what we've been watching lately, because it's time for the dance sensation that's sweeping the nation. It's the what you watching, bud. Everybody's doing it. So, Sharon, starting off with you, what you watching, bud?
What you watching, bud? I don't know what you watching, bud. I'll tell you so. Do-do-do-do-do.
So I'm watching Abbott Elementary. It is a very nice sitcom that's available. It's playing on ABC right now. It is kind of a workplace comedy, sort of in the similar vein of like Parks and Rec. It's about an underfunded school in Philadelphia. It was created by Quinta Brunson, who a lot of people know from BuzzFeed. It's very funny. It has Tyler James Williams in it. It has Cheryl Lee Ralph. I can't remember her name, but the actress that played Chessie from the Parent Trap remake with Lindsay Lohan is in it. They're all teachers. They're all overworked and underfunded. It's very funny. It's very sweet. And it's won a bunch of Emmys lately, which I think it deserves, and I hope that it runs for a while. And if you haven't seen it, you should watch it, because it's very nice.
And you can, because it's on Disney Plus here in Canada.
Oh, yeah, that's true. It's on Hulu in America, but if you're outside, you can watch it on Disney Plus and HBO Max, too, since it's made by Warner Brothers.
Before they take it off, like, in 3 weeks or something.
Oh, that makes me so mad.
Don't worry. If it makes you feel any better, Warner Brothers stock, like, plummeted today.
Oh, what from what?
Like 12 to like 3 or something like that.
Due to what?
Oh, I don't know. Just shitty business decisions, I'm guessing.
True. I think they there was some story about them with the unions, and people are like, we're mad because you're mostly cutting projects that are being made by people of color. So that might have been it.
Yeah, they shut down this whole thing that was supposed to, that was literally created to boost like voices of people that, you know, weren't white. So that didn't go down that. That didn't go down super well.
I'm still kind of smarting about the whole Batgirl debacle too.
I'm still mad about it.
That was stupid as fuck.
Yeah, Leslie Grace. Like, if anyone hasn't seen In the Heights, like, she's amazing in that. And I was so mad because I was so excited to see what else she was gonna do, and now like they canceled it, and I'm mad because again, it seemed like it was almost done, and it seems like they
it was
might,
done.
Like, It was done.
It was done. It was completely done. And they're just like, nope.
Fucking assholes.
Like, at least put it out there. Come on.
Anyway, sorry. Sorry for my digression.
No, that makes me mad. That whole thing makes me mad. Nathan, what about you? What you watching, bud?
Well, I mean, keep your angry hat on maybe for a little bit. Because I actually watched this past week a documentary called Happy Happy Joy Joy, The Ren and Stimpy Story. And it's all about the rise and fall of not only the cartoon, but its creator. I was worried when I started watching it that they were going to pull punches and things like that. But no, right at the very last of it, they get into like his really shady stuff. And they even have one of his victims interviewing. And he interviews like in the movie too. So it's definitely one of those, it's a weird experience as far as a documentary goes, because a lot of times when, you know, if the person who's at the focal point has like a shady past, they'll oftentimes, they'll either refuse to be interviewed for the documentary, or they will insist that the shady stuff be underplayed, and neither kind of happened.
Right.
So, but it actually is a really interesting insight into the development of the show too. So, I mean, if you want to know more about it and can kind of, you know, be like, okay, I can separate the art from the artist. I still like Ren and Stimpy, but John Kay can eat 1,000 burning dicks in hell. Then I check it out, because you'll see how the show kind of became what he did to kind of revolutionize and make things better for animators and creators, and then of course all the things that he did to be an awful, awful person.
Okay, so a balanced look.
It's on Tubi.
Oh, I can watch it then! Hooray!
For the price of on the house.
So, what about you, bud? What you watching?
Well, in the spirit of this movie, I watched a French movie, but an actual French movie. This is a French drama from 1967. This movie is called Belle du Jour, and it stars Catherine Deneuve as a bored housewife who finds out that she is fascinated by humiliation and sex and all this stuff, and she decides to become a lady of the night, or she works at a brothel, rather. As the movie goes through, it's not super like plot driven, but you know, her husband has this kind of creepy friend, and she ends up, you know, I mean, nobody else knows she works at the brothel. She doesn't tell her husband. She just starts working there. And, you know, the usual complications that you would imagine occur. There are some crazy, like, fantasy sequences. Like, she has a lot of, like, daydreams and stuff. And it's directed by Louis Buñuel, who did that movie with the, where they cut the eyelid.
Andalusian Dog?
Oh, no,
yeah,
no.
That's the one. But there's nothing like that in this movie. It's just...
No, I know. I hate it.
Yeah. It's not even overtly don't even think there's any like actual nudity in it, because it's 1967, so it's right on the cusp of when you could start getting away with that. And I'm sure Catherine Deneuve was like, not yet. Not until The Hunger, or maybe earlier than that, I don't know. But anyway, Belle du Jour, you can watch it on the Criterion channel. Check it out if you're into that kind of shit.
Okay.
But other than that, Montrose there to say a few words.
Yeah, I'll get in. Drag him out. You think he's sleeping? Just a second.
Yeah.
Miss Wood. Tea and scones, please.
Oh, just pitch your show, man. I know it's getting late. Just do your fucking thing.
Oh, what? Oh. Hello, this is your good friend Montrose, et cetera, check out YouTube, Montrose Marketing TV, be friends with me on Facebook, Montrose Marketing the Third, Esquire and Friends. Oh, tweet me at Montrose the Third, that's the number 3RD, thank you, more later, yeah, I'm going back to bed.
Okay, thank you, Montrose.
Go to who?
Noted. Well, Sharon, thank you for once again being on the show to talk about another wintry tale.
Bit of a stretch there.
Do you have anything you want to, you're interested in plugging, promoting, talking about?
Nah.
No?
Nah, I just like being here.
She's plugging Earth.
No, I'm at the show, but yes, I also enjoy being on planet Earth.
Overrated, okay. If you ask me.
Well, I can breathe the air without a mask on. And by mask, I mean like a helmet. I should clarify that.
Give it 20, 30 years.
God, I'm so tired.
But that's it. We're all done. Check us out all over the place. We're on all the podcast apps. Our home base is Age of Radio.
Big time!
And you can find us at on Facebook, and we're on Twitter at WWTT Podcast. Same thing on Instagram. We're also on Redbubble, TeePublic, patreon.com/WWTT podcast. And that is pretty much it. So as we close out the episode, Nathan, do you have any questions? I don't think I'm the right person to answer your questions about Phantom of the Opera. But
no, I think this should be switched around if you ask me.
But I don't have any questions. I think I know everything. So just shoot.
All right. Well, you know, okay. Well, all right, fine. You know, maybe with the film adaptation version, I might have some questions. I mean,
okay.
In a movie where you have a Scotsman playing a Frenchman.
Right.
And in a movie where you have, you know, an American playing a French Vicomte.
Yeah. Yeah. Very cosmopolitan.
And, where you have Minnie Driver playing a Spanish opera singer. You know, all that aside, with, you know, the Phantom's face being maybe only a little more deformed than Kane's was when they finally revealed his face on WWE. And all the masks that he goes through to hide this minor deformity, I just gotta know. What were they thinking?
Damn you! You little blind Pandora! You little demon! Is this what you wanted to see? Curse you! You little lying Delilah! You little viper! Now you cannot ever be free! Damn you! Curse you! Stranger than you dreamt it, can you even dare to look or bear to think of me? This loathsome gargoyle who burns in hell, but secretly yearns for heaven. Secretly, secretly, oh, Christine. Fear can turn to love. You'll learn to see, to find the man behind the monster. This repulsive carcass who seems a beast, but secretly dreams of beauty, secretly dreams.